Hello and welcome to India's World. Today we are going to discuss the Rohingya refugee crisis. The flight of the Rohingyas from Myanmar and Bangladesh is being described as Asia's biggest mass exodus by sea since the end of the Vietnam War. The Rohingyas, a minority Muslim community in a predominantly Buddhist Myanmar, reside mainly in the Rakhine province of that country. This is also known as the Arakan region. After the major Buddhist Rohingya riots of 2012, a large number of the Rohingyas fled to the neighboring Bangladesh. Tens of thousands who remained back became internally displaced, and their properties were destroyed, and they were chased out of their homes. They now live in crowded camps within Myanmar. Periodically, they try and escape the inhuman conditions they are forced to live in. They do so by boats and are facilitated by people smugglers. As in the past, they have sought greener pastures in Malaysia, Thailand, and Indonesia. None of these countries want them now. While most of the escaping migrants, referred to as Southeast Asia's boat people, come from the Rakhine state of Myanmar, a considerable portion of them also comes from Bangladesh. To discuss the Rohingya migrant crisis, we have with us three distinguished experts. We have with us Ambassador Vivek Katju. He was India's ambassador to Afghanistan, Thailand, and Myanmar. We have with us Ambassador Pinak Ranjan Chakravarti, once again a senior diplomat and a former secretary in the Ministry of External Affairs. He's been India's ambassador to Thailand and High Commissioner to Bangladesh. And we also have with us Professor G. Vijayachandra Naidu. He's a professor at the Center for Indo-Pacific Studies at the School of International Studies of Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. I welcome you, gentlemen, to this discussion. Vivek, let me begin by asking you, set the context for us. How old is this migrant crisis of Southeast Asia, and what has led to the crisis becoming so acute this time around?
The roots of the problem go back decades. In fact, I think it goes back more than a century. It didn't begin, therefore, in 2012. The Arakan region has a Buddhist population, as well as it has these Rohingyas, and then there are some other native Muslims. Now, the Myanmar authorities have consistently claimed over the decades, in fact, since before their independence, that the Rohingyas were not native to Myanmar or to Arakan, that they were migrants, and that from time to time, their migration has resulted in an augmentation in their numbers, and it has caused them problems. Now, there is the politics of Myanmar, which is which cannot only be viewed in Buddhist, non-Buddhist terms. That politics is also rooted in British colonialism, which fought a war. You know, the Brits fought a war against the Burmese ethnic group. So the Burmese ethnic group has always been very sensitive about any pressures on it. And therefore, they find it difficult to accept anyone who becomes like the Rohingyas. In fact, the Rohingyas were not given statehood, and they were not considered a nationality, unlike the Shans or the Wa, etc. Now, this is not peculiar to the Rohingyas only. The Indians who have settled in Myanmar, for example, have also not been given a nationality. There are about 400,000 of them.
No, I agree. But I don't want to go to Indians. That's a separate issue altogether. Pinak, why are the Rohingyas fleeing Myanmar? After all, if this is a century-old problem, then why are they fleeing in such large numbers now? And why are they fleeing from Bangladesh, where some of them have escaped to in the past?
Well, those who are fleeing from Bangladesh, let's make a difference here, because those who are fleeing from Bangladesh are Bangladeshis. They're not necessarily Rohingyas.
Some of them are Rohingyas.
Some are Rohingyas, because in Chittagong, for example, or actually more down south in Cox's Bazar, there are huge camps of these people, the refugees and things like that. Now, why are they escaping now? You know, Burma itself or Myanmar itself has been changing. There are internal pressures growing there. And clearly, they are now being persecuted to such an extent, or their conditions have become so bad, that they've probably feel that the risk of taking, you know, going outside, you know, going in a boat, coming into the grips of these human traffickers who operate, by the way, out of both Bangladesh and Myanmar, And you know, in Thailand, what has happened is 50 policemen have been indicted. And one of the military governors of the southern province, where there is a near the Malaysian border, has actually surrendered to the police for an investigation. So there is a huge trafficking mafia that is taking care of, or rather encouraging this thing, because they make money out of it. You've seen the stories coming out of Malaysia. Also.
Absolutely. Professor Naidu, roughly what proportion of these boat people are Rohingyas? And what proportion is Bangladeshis? And are the Bangladeshis purely economic migrants as opposed to Rohingyas, who may be economic migrants plus people who feel political persecution?
See, the problem is numbers. You know, we don't know exactly how many are still adrift at the sea and how many have actually landed at shore and how many have been thrown back. We don't know the information. Whatever little information that comes, it looks like the numbers are substantial. It looks like at least anything between 8,000 to 10,000 people are somewhere there, either at sea or landed illegally. And again, nobody is sure how many of them are economic migrants. In a sense, I'm looking for better opportunities. And quite a few of Bangladeshis, it seems looks like that, are economic migrants. They're not really politically persecuted in that sense, unlike the Rohingyas. And part of that is that in Rohingyas, we've been been in the camp, refugee camps for a long time in Bangladesh. And they see absolutely no future in Bangladesh at all. So these are, those are substantial numbers who, along with Bangladeshis, are taking the boats and ramshackle boats, and they're landing up in Malaysia, Indonesia, and Thailand. Partly because they see better economic opportunity there, and partly because of the Islamic connection and all that. More importantly, there's been a constant flow of Rohingyas, and a small percentage of Bangladeshis have been going to, especially to Malaysia, for a long time. Yeah. It's nothing new.
Okay.
They've been there for the last 15, 16 years.
But let me take that question to Vivek. So would it be correct to say that every year between fall and before the beginning of the monsoon, the Rohingyas routinely migrate for better prospects to greener pastures in Malaysia, Indonesia, and Thailand?
Yes, but not in these numbers. The 2012 riots were a watershed. After that, the relations between the Burmese ethnic group and Buddhist ethnic groups in the Arakan and the Rohingyas absolutely deteriorated. There was great violence, and therefore there's also fear for their lives, and the conditions in the camps in Myanmar are quite miserable. So that has added to the migration.
All right. Okay, so we'll discuss the relationship between the various ethnicities of Myanmar in a bit, but we need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again with this interesting discussion in a bit. Stay with us. Welcome back. We're discussing the Rohingya migrant crisis. Professor Naidu, we were discussing the relationship between the Buddhist majority in Myanmar and the minorities, especially the Rohingyas. So why was it in 1982, General Nevin, when he brought in the Nationality Act, why did he deny the Rohingyas citizenship?
Actually, if you really look at it, the relationship has always been very tenuous. When the British took large number of, the Rohingyas, from present-day Bangladesh, they wanted them to work in the fields. The Rakhine is one of the, wealthiest regions, very fertile, region. So they very sparsely populated. So that's one of the major, the contradictions that arose, the tensions that arose. Once these people went, they brought in along with them, several people over the years. So that, the question of owning the land and, the controlling the, the land is the major thing. Emotionally, we're attached to that, especially those days. So ever since this problem has been simmering, 1982, when there was huge pressure on Nevin, for instance. So one of the things, any government in Myanmar, any leader has to take into account, the Sangha, the Buddhist clergy. And Buddha, that's the biggest constituency. Everyone has to address. That's one of the reasons why, Aung San Suu Kyi is not saying a word about that. She did not say a word about it in the past, and she's not saying now. In fact, she has come under intense criticism by, the international community, including Dalai Lama and, Bishop Tutu and all others. So that is something I can know any leader can pander to the local Buddhism or Buddhist constituency. So one of the easiest targets is the Rohingyas.
Why only the Rohingyas, Pinak? Because after all, 135 national races are recognized in Myanmar, and not all of them are Buddhists, because up in the north, in the hills, the crescents that surrounds the Burmans and the plains, there are Christians also there. So were they targeted because they were Muslims?
That is a factor, I think.
So why not target the Christians also
there? No, somehow the Buddhists, first of all, the migration issue, they regard the Christians as more indigenous in terms of, whereas the Rakhine and the Rakhine people, or the Rohingyas as we call it, are regarded as migrants. And like in India, we use the word infiltrators and all kinds of things, illegal migrants. So they are basically regarded as Bangladeshis, period. I mean, that is the view that...
But are they Bangladeshis? Because the language is completely different.
Well, it's a mixture now.
Even from Chittagongian.
Yes, it's a mixture now, because they, over the years, as Vivek was saying, this is not something new. The migration took place during colonial times, the resettlement, etc.
Although there are Rohingya scholars who say that they were indigenous to that area.
They intermarried, of course. Many of them intermarried. So if you look at them today, they, of course, look different also. That is another factor, by the way, that they look different. They have a different religion than the native, the original sort of Buddhists and some Christians who are there. So that's a factor. But ultimately, I think it's both political and cultural and religious. I think it's a mixture of all that.
Yeah.
And even as Professor said, Aung San Suu Kyi has been forced to keep quiet on something, as major as this that has been happening. Okay. But let us also not forget that they are a very old community. It began with the Arab geographers. If you read the Arab geographers, Masudi and others, you will find that settlements of Arab traders actually had settled in these regions and brought Islam. And that's how
I suppose the question is, how many of them are descendants of those Arabs, and how many of them were people who were taken as plantation labor by the British?
Well, obviously the descendants of the Arabs are minimal, few. And it's basically the migrants who went, who settled there, like the British did to, in India, to take Indians to various parts of the world, in fact, as migrants.
But Vivek, how far can one go in saying that who is the original inhabitant, who's not? So why are they subject to systematic campaign of persecution, violence and exclusion? And do you think there is genocide and ethnic cleansing going on, that the Myanmaris want this to happen?
Look, the politics of ethnicity in Myanmar is terribly complex.
But they've handled it very well, Rohingyas and the Kachins. No, they've handled it pretty well.
No. Please understand the roots of this problem first. You said that, and rightly, that the plains of Myanmar are inhabited predominantly by the Burmans, and the hills ringing these plains were inhabited by other tribes. Now, those tribes have been living there for centuries, and there was a lot of evangelical activity among them. So this was a contradiction which is still there in Myanmar. The third element are people the Burmans consider to be complete immigrants.
That's right.
Who are different. The Indians were in the same category. You will remember that in 1964 there was an exodus of Indians. He forced Indians with property, others to go out. The only ones who remain, and that is relevant to this issue, the only ones those who remain are about 4 lakhs who live in villages, Ziawadi, etc., and who are still stateless.
So they're in Yangon too, and Mandalay.
No, and they are stateless. They haven't been given nationality, so this is not a unique problem.
Okay.
But two more points. One, it is, as Pinak said rightly, that there is a religious element to this. There is, the Sangh is militant.
Absolutely.
And Islam worldwide is becoming militant, so there is this problem.
The Rohingyas themselves used militancy at one point.
Yes, so
it's not as if they were
peace-loving people. In 1942, they were the instruments of oppression against the Burmans, and they were mobilized by the British. So colonial problems exacerbated. Colonialism exacerbated these. So while today there is every justification for treating them humanely and addressing the humanitarian crisis, But the politics of ethnicity, race in Burma has to be understood.
Okay. Professor Naidu, what is the choice before the Rohingyas? Should they stay on in Myanmar and suffer persecution? They tried moving to Bangladesh where they are fellow Muslims, but, you know, that's not where they're going to get jobs. So, what is wrong if they take these dangerous sea journeys and look for a better future for themselves?
See, that's the quandary or dilemma these people are faced with. And they stay, they get persecuted. They stay, go out, they equally get persecuted, face very bleak future. That's the reason why, large number of them are taken to the sea, the boats, yep, and all that.
Okay.
Yeah, please.
No, please.
No, that is the problem. That's actually, contributing to the crisis in a bigger way, because they just don't know what to do. Up to the Myanmarese government to come to terms with the reality that, these are their people. Okay. They have been there for more than a century. Okay. The recent migrant, they can, separate them, but those who have been there for a long time, they have to be accommodated. There's absolutely no way they can escape.
They suffer all over. There are 3 lakhs in Saudi Arabia.
Exactly.
And their condition is miserable.
Well, there are a few thousand in India.
Yeah. Yes.
As well.
Okay. But we need to take a break at this point. We'll be back again with this discussion in a bit. Stay with us. Welcome back. We're discussing the Rohingya migrant crisis. Pinak, do you agree with those who point out that several of these Southeast Asian countries which are refusing to take the Rohingya migrants have in the past benefited through this migration? Malaysia used them as cheap labor. Thailand, you yourself point out, the governor himself was involved in human trafficking. The police made money out of it, and they facilitated this migration in the past. So the beneficiaries of past migration have today turned against migration.
You know, this double standard exists all over the world. Mm. It is not just in Malaysia or Indonesia. In Thailand, they exploit the people from Myanmar who are there in large numbers and who are undocumented, many of them, and they are terribly exploited in their plantations, in other industries that Thailand runs along the border. And also because now I think in Malaysia and Indonesia, they have reached a stage where there is now developing local opposition to these people coming in. And that is where it all begins. When there is a local opposition, once they have been used, as you said, the industries or others, plantations where they needed these cheap labor, which added to their exports, for example. Till that, it's fine. And when it was a trickle, it's fine. Now, the numbers have grown. And that is why when they are reaching these countries, so there is now developing local opposition. Okay. In fact, they are probably taking away jobs from locals. Okay. And that is where the problem starts.
So Vivek, let's look at the legal aspects of it, the international law aspect of it. Of Myanmar's ASEAN neighbors, only Cambodia, Philippines and East Timor have signed the UN Convention on Refugees, which prevents pushback of refugees.
Yeah.
Okay? Otherwise, you're obliged to give shelter to refugees as the first country they come into. Now, despite this, do you think the other countries, despite the fact that they have not signed this UN Convention, are they morally obliged to take in the refugees? And if they take in these refugees, then would it not encourage more people to take to rickety boats and migrate to these countries?
This is one of those classic cases of a no-win situation. You are right. All countries take advantage of illegal migrants at a certain stage in their evolution. And the Americans are doing it even now. But once that stage is crossed, then you want to prevent this. But at the same time, these migrants have to be treated humanely, even if you haven't signed the convention. India is not a signatory to the convention. But I was personally told once by the High Commissioner for Refugees. He's told me that India's record of dealing with illegal migrants is excellent, even though you are not a signatory.
Except when the Nepalese expelled from Bhutan, where we pushed them into Nepal rather than keeping them.
Look, how many migrants do we have? Let's not talk of one isolated case. You've had migrants.
Bangladeshi migrants we are not very tolerant of. So what are we talking about?
No, tolerant of, but how many have you pushed, really pushed back? There are millions. Have you pushed them back? Let's take a holistic picture.
they remain here as illegal people. It's not as if you've given them refugee status.
You can't give legal status to millions upon millions.
What is the point you're making?
The point I'm making is the point I'm making is that being a signatory to the convention is not a requirement to treating illegal migrants in a humane
manner. That's a well point. That's a point I'll make, that you can take a moral position without taking a legal position.
Yes.
Okay, Professor Naidu, will Myanmar realize that by pushing the Rohingyas like this, it's actually ruining its relationship with two of its biggest markets, that is Indonesia and Malaysia?
No, actually, right now Myanmar is not that dependent on Malaysia or Indonesian markets. The major markets are in the Western, basically textiles, for instance. It's not really that developed industry they have, and much of the raw material goes to commodities and all that. They go to China, to an extent, a little bit to India. So they're not that dependent.
But they remain ASEAN's two biggest markets.
Their position in ASEAN has been under intense pressure, because being a member of ASEAN and some of the members are putting enormous pressure. But the ASEAN also, in a way, is helpless. That's what Lee Hsiang Lee said day before yesterday, that, what can ASEAN do? It's it's up to Myanmar to do, to deal with the situation. And you also can't expect other countries to endlessly take the refugees.
So do you agree with what Professor Naidu is saying and what ASEAN leaders are saying, that the problem sources Myanmar and the only solution of the problem lies within Myanmar?
I think, of course, that is where the problem is, and it has to be sorted out there. But if you recall, there was a recent conference in Bangkok where all the ASEAN countries met to discuss this issue. So obviously there is some pressure also being put on the Myanmarese government. There is international pressure as well, because of United Nations interest and the High Commissioner for Refugees. So ultimately a solution will have to be found. Either some people will get absorbed, those who are already on the high seas and are floating around. But one of the things that's why Thailand has become the conduit, as a transit country. So that's where the Thai Prime Minister, the former general, took the initiative to have this conference in Bangkok to basically discuss it as to what do we do with it.
All right. So let me take this question to you now, Vivek. So do you think ASEAN can learn from what EU is doing? I mean, EU is also faced with its boat people, the refugees, 20,000 refugees who have landed on its southern borders. The EU has come up with a formula of sharing the burden. Of course, there's a debate whether this burden, sharing of this burden should be mandatory, should it be voluntary. But that's the only solution EU has found. Do you think ASEAN needs to use a similar approach?
I think ASEAN and EU's dynamics are very different. For one, ASEAN has this position of not really intervening or interfering in the internal affairs of their member states, unlike EU. So let's not. But yes, some solution to the humanitarian crisis is to be found.
What solution?
And that solution has to be on some kind of settlement in camps, and the camps run in a good, humane fashion in the countries which are closest to where the boats are found. Because you can't let people perish in this day and age. You can't let them die on the high seas. So that is one solution. As far as the political solution to staunch the flow is concerned, I must confess I'm not very hopeful. I'm a little pessimistic, given the manner in which Myanmar politics is poised at the moment, and where, as my co-panelists have mentioned, even Aung San Suu Kyi has not spoken at all on this issue. And there the key to understanding this lies in the dynamics within the Burman community, which after all then controls Myanmar.
So if Aung San Suu Kyi has lost her moral lustre and wants to be a leader only of the Buddhist Burmans, then clearly there's no hope for the Rohingyas ever getting citizenship. Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm not saying that she's given up this, but she has never not been a realist. People who look at Aung San Suu Kyi's record must realize that her fight was against the army. An army which really her father had created. An army which was controlling the Burmans.
So
she wants democratization.
I think that's
too drastic a statement. She is bothered, but she has political compulsions.
Exactly.
You must understand her compulsions. It's not black and white.
Okay. even if that political compulsion costs thousands of lives. But I'm afraid we've run out of time. I'd like to thank all my guests, Professor Vijay Chandra Naidu, Ambassador Pinak Chakravarti, and Ambassador Vivek Karju. Thank you very much for coming here and participating in this discussion. That is all we have for you today. We'll be back again as usual next week. Till then, goodbye, and thanks for watching India's World.